In a recent episode, we began an examination of the Baltic republics, how they went from independent nations during the interwar period to Soviet republics. The signing of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact in 1939 had begun the process, and their annexation by the summer of 1940 brought to an end their independence. But the fate of these three Soviet republics was to be a rocky one, to say the least, but would eventually lead to a legal position that spearheaded the collapse of the Soviet Union. I'm your host, David, and this week we are looking at the wartime and post-war fate of Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania. This is the Cold War. Learning new information is an enormous part of my everyday life, which is why I am so thrilled to be working with the sponsor of today's video, a rising star in the streaming world, Magellan TV. Not only is Magellan TV the highest rated documentary streaming app on Google Play, but it offers the best value of any premium documentary streaming service for both its price and especially its quality. And the reason is that Magellan TV is all about the drama of real life, the lives of ancient pharaohs, critical battles in World War I and II, soldiers who fought in the Civil War, the battles for control of the English crown, the Norman conquest. Join us in watching North Korea versus USA, a game of nuclear chicken, and learn about the 60-year quest by the Kims for global acknowledgement. Magellan TV has the largest and best collection of history shows anywhere, and there are over 20 hours of new content added weekly. Not only are there no ads ever, but your subscription always includes 4K. Click the link in the description and join us today. We left off our first episode on this topic with the 1940 formal annexations of the three republics. Once annexed, Sovietization began apace, looking to transform the economic life of these former countries. But it didn't begin with mass collectivization. Instead, a more gradual path was taken, beginning with land reforms, limiting a person's maximum land holdings to 30 hectares. Although several kolkhozes were created, the main focus of the land reform was to provide support for new farmers who had taken over lands confiscated from owners who had previously owned more than 30 hectares. In the urban areas, however, more changes were made, and faster. Banks, industries, commerce, transportation were all nationalized, and taxes were increased. The Soviet ruble replaced each of the local currencies, and anyone who had more than 1,000 rubles had the excess taken. The length of the working day was extended, and it became more difficult for workers to change jobs. And the results of these changes? Well, living standards, which had been higher in the independent republics compared to the Soviet Union, dropped dramatically. Opposition to the changes was met with arrest, deportation, or even execution. For many, especially military officers, members of the intelligentsia, anti-communists, and members of the elite, remaining in their homes was no option, and they fled the region en masse. For example, many of the ethnic Baltic Germans who were still living in the area were repatriated to Germany. Now, as I just mentioned, deportations began almost as soon as the annexations took place, and those forcibly sent to the east included government officials, politicians, and members of the military of the once free republics. But these deportations were still relatively limited in scale. It wasn't until the following summer, starting on the 13th and 14th of June 1941, that the scale dramatically increased. On those dates, an estimated 34,000 Lithuanians, 15,500 Latvians, and 10,000 Estonians were rounded up and sent to Siberia and the Soviet East. Anyone who was even suspected of being disloyal to the new regime was deported and purged. The estimates of the total number of people who suffered from some form of repression at the hands of the Soviet Union are as many as 34,000 in Latvia, 60,000 in Estonia, and up to 75,000 in Lithuania. As a result of these deportations and repressions, June 14th is observed in all three of the Baltic republics as a day of remembrance. But for those of you looking at the date of June 14th, 1941, and thinking it looks awfully familiar, it was only 8 days before the Germans launched Operation Barbarossa, invading their erstwhile ally. It did not take long for the Soviet occupation to be replaced with a German one. And it wasn't necessarily that the Balts were pro-German, in fact there was fairly substantive anti-German sentiment, But because the anti-Soviet feeling was so strong, the advancing Germans were greeted as liberators. Local populations took advantage of the advancing Germans to launch attacks of their own against Soviet soldiers and NKVD personnel. These attacks were so strong, in fact, that in places like Lithuania, the Soviets were driven back before the Germans even arrived. Some of these Baltic-led attacks were attempts to free some of the political prisoners who had not yet been deported eastwards. While some were freed, at least 5,000 prisoners were executed by the NKVD before the Soviets' own retreat. The Germans, however, did not come as liberators, and they had no intention of respecting Latvia's, Estonia's, or Lithuania's sovereignty. The German occupation of the Baltics lasted from 1941 to 1944 and was marked by repressions, economic depredation and devastation, racial intolerance, and the Germanization of the population. During the occupation, it's estimated that 300,000 Jews and 35,000 ethnic Lithuanians, Estonians, and Latvians were killed. Despite this, as the fortunes of war changed and the Red Army advanced in 1944, as many as 200,000 Balts fled their homes towards Germany, Finland, Sweden, and other countries who would take them, the terrible memories of the Soviet occupation still looming large in their minds. In addition, thousands of others took up arms, planning to resist the return of the Red Army. The enemy of my enemy is my friend, and all of that. The Soviet reoccupation of the Baltic states and their reincorporation into the USSR was met with very little opposition on the international stage. None of the three states had governments in exile in the West representing the rights of each of the republics and lobbying for their cause. As such, it was relatively easy for the Western allies to simply ignore their plight. With the final results of the war in Europe still uncertain, neither the United States or the United Kingdom were willing to risk the needed relationship with the Soviets over the fate of the three countries. Countries which many in the West regarded as Russian anyway. When their right to self-determination for Estonia, Lithuania, and Latvia was simply not mentioned at Yalta by the Western allies, the Soviet Union took this as tacit acceptance that the territory was theirs and they were reincorporated to the USSR. The Balts, for their part, looked at the Soviet return as not a liberation, but another occupation. The first one had been the result of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, which had been deemed illegal and invalid once Nazi Germany attacked the Soviet Union. The Soviets, however, with none of the powers of the West willing or able to vouch for the Baltic republics, simply ignored the questionable grounds which their claims to the region rested upon and kept the territory for themselves. Stalin, back in the Baltic saddle, resumed the repressions. There are estimates that as much as 9% of the population was impacted by the mass deportations, the executions, and the military operations conducted to put down the resistance groups which emerged in the face of what many locals saw as being an illegal occupation. Those targeted included, but weren't limited to, both real and perceived collaborators with the Nazi regime, those who had served in the German or Finnish armies, large landowners, and generally anybody who opposed Soviet policies. Between August and September 1945, 60,000 people were deported from Lithuania, with another 40,000 following them in February 1946. A total of 60,000 Latvians were deported over the same time period. Deportations would be used as a tool by the authorities against anti-Soviet elements from 1944 through to the early 1950s, really only stopping after Stalin's death. But it wasn't used just to maintain order, but also to help enact policy. Unlike the first occupation, which you will recall from our first episode, which had tried to implement land reform rather than collectivization, this occupation was looking to totally alter the Baltic farming scene. Initial attempts to collectivize met with little success. By 1948, only 4-8% of farmers had transitioned onto kolkhoz. The government response was to use brutal force. Starting on March 25, 1949, Operatsiya Priboy was conducted, where resistant farmers were simply deported to Siberia and the East. Approximately 30,000 Lithuanians, over 22,000 Estonians, and as many as 43,000 Latvians were put on trains over a three-day period and sent away. This amounted to about 3% of the region's total population. The result of this, however, was that by the end of the year, 80% of all arable land had been collectivized. This, like had occurred so often before, however, had a terrible short-term result. The amount of cultivated land had dropped by between 15 and 25% by 1955 when compared to 1940. Now, unlike the first Soviet occupation, the second occupation was met with armed resistance. We've done an episode previously discussing the Forrest brothers, so we won't go into a ton of detail here, but only give a brief outline. Estimates are that even by 1945, there were about 15,000 people who had taken up arms against the Soviet presence in the Baltics. The Forrest brothers were actually one of the primary reasons the early collectivization efforts were so poor. The guerrillas derived much of their strength from the countryside. Much of the resistance was concentrated in Lithuania, where over the following years, upwards of 70,000 people fought with the brothers. The Soviets responded with force, creating a special group under the command of one of Stalin's key aides, Mikhail Suslov. This force consisted of two divisions of elite NKVD troops and seven independent regiments used to suppress the resistance. The Soviet Union was too powerful and able to deploy too much force to not eventually defeat the Forrest brothers, but not before losing about 20,000 men in the process. Of course, Stalin's death and the ending of targeted repressions also had a huge impact on bringing an end to the resistance. So, what effect does 10 years of deportations, repressions, and war have on local populations? Well, devastating would be an understatement. Keeping in mind that the Baltic republics are themselves relatively small and have populations to match, the result was that as much as 20% of the overall population had been lost. Now, the cultural and emotional impact aside, this had a tremendous economic impact on the region as well. The population losses were especially keenly felt in the loss of men of working age, meaning even after peace had been restored, there were tremendous shortages in the workforce. The Soviet solution was to fill the vacancies with ethnic Russian settlers. This was not met well by the Baltic nations, bitter and angry after years of suffering at the hands of the Soviets, seen as an extension of the same Russians that had dominated them in the days of the Empire. Census data shows the scale of this migration. Between 1959 and 1979, the percentage of Estonians in Estonia dropped from 75.6% of the population to 64.7%. Conversely, the percentage of ethnic Russians increased from 21% to 27.9%. In Latvia, the percentage of ethnic Latvians who made up the population dropped from 62% to 53.7%. The ethnic Russian population increased over the same time period from 30.9% to 40% over the same time. Lithuania, interestingly, largely escaped this demographic shift, with ethnic Lithuanians consistently making up about 80% of the population. Of course, there were other changes pursued to tie the Baltic republics into the Soviet fold. Starting from the fifth five-year plan in 1950, Moscow began the process of incorporating the region into the overall Soviet industrial network. As what happened in other Union republics, new industrial facilities were a key part of this plan, with the supplies to make these facilities run coming from other republics. And everything was designed for the overall benefit of the Soviet Union, not the individual republic. This shifted somewhat after Khrushchev's reforms, including the creation of the National Economic Councils, the Sovnarkhoz. This act of decentralization allowed the Baltics and the other Union republics to have a greater degree of autonomy over decision-making in local industries. As a result, in Estonia, Lithuania, and Latvia, more than 80% of industrial input shifted to Republican control. In addition, the three were able to take advantage of the pre-war industrial and transportation infrastructure that remained, which really boosted their output. As a result, by 1968, the per capita income in Estonia exceeded the Soviet average by 44%, 42% in Latvia, and 15% in Lithuania. The progressive policies of Khrushchev, however, were ended in 1964 after his ouster from power, and 1968 remained the high point for the Soviet Baltic republics. Sovietization, as we've discussed in several earlier episodes, also paid attention to education and cultural life. Ideology was pushed through the school system, and children were taught that it was only through the care and protection of the Soviet Union that their republics and people could prosper. Culturally, religion and the church, long central parts of Baltic life and identity, were suppressed. Church property was confiscated and attendance was strongly discouraged. And how to maintain control in these newly incorporated republics? Well, by manipulating party politics, naturally. In the early 1950s, a series of purges were carried out, targeting the leadership of each of the republic's communist parties. In Estonia, through 1950 and 1951, the first secretary, the prime minister, and the chairman of the Supreme Soviet were each accused of bourgeois nationalism. 1952 saw the chairman of the Latvian Supreme Soviet accused of the same thing. By removing old leadership and replacing them with more pliant candidates, who were more dependent on Moscow, political leadership remained under central control. So, we were just discussing ethnicity and changes in the republics? Well, this had an impact on governance of each of the Baltic Union republics. The first secretary of the Communist Party in each republic was always from the titular ethnicity, an Estonian in Estonia, a Lithuanian in Lithuania, and a Latvian in Latvia. However, the second secretary, a role which held enormous power and influence, was almost always held by an ethnic Russian. The role of the second secretary was usually to control the party cadres, and they normally had very close ties back to the center in Moscow. This system is quite emblematic of the distrust of those in the republics, who were often seen as less reliable than ethnic Russians. This was despite many of the Baltic leadership, especially in the immediate post-war period, being largely Russified and unwaveringly loyal. This system of ethnic assignment was not just used in the Republic Communist Party, but also in the state security apparatus, the KGB. Chiefs of the Republic branch of the KGB were from the titular ethnicity, but their deputy was almost always Russian. Ethnicity also mattered when it came to membership in the party. Russians were disproportionately overrepresented as party members. In Latvia in 1973, for example, 54% of party members were Russian, despite Russians making up less than 30% of the population. Now, this is either because Russians were favored for party membership, or, much more likely, the Baltic people were less likely to buy into the indoctrination of Soviet ideology. And where does this leave us? Well, it means that as the Soviet period continued and as stagnation and discontent set in, there were three Union republics who, by the 1980s, still had real, living memories of independence. They had clearly identified ethnicities, which had been able to moderately resist the processes of Russification and Sovietization. They identified as occupied peoples, forced into colonial subjugation and kept in check by the forces exerted by the center. When the reins of power were loosened, the desire for independence quickly sprang to the surface. It was in the Baltic republics that the beginning of the end of the Soviet Union occurred, by holding hands, and by singing, and by rising up. We will come back to the Baltic story in a future episode to talk about these events, how the terms by which the republics had been annexed were deemed illegal, and eventually how these actions of the three Baltic republics helped to bring down a superpower. We hope you've enjoyed this episode, and to make sure you don't miss our future work, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have pressed the bell button before it gets occupied three separate and vicious times in the space of 5 years. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.